World Soul Food Podcast is back.
Yeah, man.
We took a week off because we were busy, huh?
All over the place,
huh? All over the place, man. Rodrigo was on Be Real TV.
Yeah, man.
Showed up with a green t-shirt for the green screen.
Hell yeah, fucking hologram, dog.
Oh, I saw your arms, bro. I saw your arms in your head, bro. You kept disappearing, bro.
I was a hologram, fool.
Did they give you a different shirt?
No, fool. Those fools didn't even know till like after. Like the fucking dude came up to me after. He's like, yeah, man, but I was able to blend you in, dude. Just like a hologram. But everybody's seen your face. It's cool.
Crazy.
Yeah, it looked weird. And some other fools were, yeah, dog.
Other fools smoke pot, so they're not ready to call people and tell them what's going on.
Hell, they're all with their sunglasses on, fool. I was just fucking chilling.
You do any dabs over there with Be Real?
Yeah, no, that fool wasn't there, dog. He was fucking doing rehearsals, dog.
What?
For that fucking, for his, you know, the Prophets of Rage. But, we did dabs before the show, dog, and after, dog, and then fucking smoked some fat-ass joints on the air and just chilling with those fools, dog.
Did you get one to go, dog?
Oh, yeah, I got one to go. All right, dog. Please, dog, you know what I'm saying?
All right, man. First of all, man, we're glad to be back, man. We were a lot of places. We're in Pueblo, Colorado.
Tucson, Arizona.
Tucson, Arizona.
West Palm Beach before that.
West Palm Beach. Also,
just got back from Chi-Town.
We're in Chicago, man. Chicago. We had a Chicago Diner.
Hell yeah, twice.
This fool hooked up this badass wrestling shirt. You got one too, right? With a zipper in the back?
Yeah, it has the back of the wrestling mats where you sew it in. Those are from Mexico, fool.
Yeah.
I got a Santos one. You got a Mil Máscaras one. I got a Blue Demon one, but I got a, you know, 10 pounds less, dude, so it can fit perfect.
Man, we ate a lot of vegan food, but I went to a vegan place. No, we were at that festival, the Pilsen Festival, yeah, in Chicago.
Pilsen,
man, there was a lot of raza over there, huh?
Grip, fool.
You didn't I thought it was in Whittier, bro.
Ah, this fool, dog.
I thought it was in Whittier, California, bro.
A grip of fucking
raza. I thought it was in Norwalk.
Hell yeah.
It felt like City Terror without mountains.
Yeah, Huntington Park a little bit, but cleaner, eh?
Yes. Man, remember we saw like stuff, street food that you only see in, on the Travel Channel with Anthony Bourdain and that fat fool with the glasses that always begging for hugs.
Zimmerman?
Andy Zimmerman. Yeah. No, that's a shooter, right?
Zimmerman, what's his name? Fucking
yeah, the fat fool from the Food Network, man. I like his show, but I wanted to punch him in the face, bro, when he got grossed out drinking horchata.
What the fuck is he talking
about?
The
motherfucker
about?
Eats donkey dicks with butter, bro, and lemon. And one little sip of horchata.
Horchata is delicious, dude.
I want to body slam him, bro.
I don't know what he's talking about, fool.
Anyway, so the kind of food that piece of shit eats, you know, and Anthony Bourdain, you know, it was you know that rotten corn?
Yeah, it's right there in it's the southern Mexico, right? In Jalisco too. What? Tijuin?
Yes. No, not Tijuin. No, it was what? Like a rotten corn. Like they let this corn rot and then it turns purple.
Ferment.
It'll ferment in the corn. That's what the lady was making. She was making quesadillas with this fermented corn, and the whole masa was the whole corn was blue.
Well, the quesadilla that I ate was blue corn. The mole.
The good.
That was fucking bomb, dog.
I had a couple of chorizo tacos that were bomb.
Hell yeah. We got those churros too?
Yeah, man. So today, man.
What's up?
I just forgot, bro.
Tell me, dog.
I was at least wanting to get our nails done. We've been busy all week. I mean, it's extremely busy because we're shooting that special in San Jose. Both shows are sold out, by the way.
Oh, so they're done with. Okay, cool. Done. Cool.
Fuck all that's left is Friday.
Sunday?
Thursday and Sunday. Friday and Sunday. That's it. Also, man. Brea, get tickets for Brea, man. Next week, it's almost sold out.
Damn, all right, the 1st to the 4th?
Yes. Also, shout out, man, to what is it right there?
To Edius Armenta, Aries. Early. That's Early E-R-L-E-E, Armenta. Listening from San Diego. Thanks for the iTunes review, and we'll see you on October 21st at Humphreys by the Bay in San Diego.
Also, Sean Russin, Reagan 23, Imaguirre, and Chia 2626 for the nice iTunes reviews. Chaka Khan. Chaka Khan. Chaka Khan.
Chaka Khan.
Chaka Khan for his story about running into the devil at the local bar comedy show.
That was a funny ass story.
He wrote that, right?
Yeah.
He wrote on the iTunes, man. If you want to hear a funny story about Chaka Khan
no spoilers.
Running into the devil at a local bar comedy show, go check it out, man. This guy was dropping different shit about the podcast. Low-key punking him.
The last one was the best, though.
He kept saying, what's up, man? You're afraid of slippers?
But the last one, you guys got to read the review. That last one had me on the fucking floor, dog.
What do you do for a living? I'm a fireman.
Dick, he gave it away. Nah, no. It's fucking funny, though, man.
Anyway, we'll scratch that out. Also, man, upcoming shows. San Jose, August 26th to the 28th. I'll be at the Improv. I'm also filming my next special there on Saturday the 27th. Both shows are sold out. Both Saturday shows are sold out.
That's awesome, dude.
So hurry and get your tickets for the Friday or Sunday show. Listen, people. Forget about these shows in the West Coast. They're going to do well. We need help in Boston.
Stay strong,
Rhode Island. If you guys know anybody out there, like anybody that can help us promote, we'll give you five tickets. Five. A couple of tickets. Boston, Rhode Island. I know it's all about Boston baked beans, but any refried beans over there, let me know. We need your help. Also, Brea, September 1st through the 4th at the Improv, Saturday Late Show is already sold out, so hurry and get tickets for these shows. I mean, they're going fast. The OC is representing. Naples, Florida, September 8th through the 10th at Off the Hook Comedy Club. Hit us up for some free tickets for the Naples, Florida shows. We have a few free ones left for our listeners. Email us at fans@felipesworld.com to request them. Oxnard, California, September 15th through the 18th at Levity Live Oxnard. Levity Live Oxnard. Man, these tickets are going to go fast too, so get your tickets, man. We already have a cool lineup ready. Rhode Island and Boston, like I said earlier, September 22nd and 23rd. We still need help promoting those shows since that's not a big market for me. Or is it? Please spread the word, and if you want to help promote by passing out some flyers and posters to local businesses, we'll give you a free ticket for helping. Just email us at fans@felipesworld.com for details. All shows can be found on felipesworld.com/tour. All right. Took my breath away. My breath away.
What's up? What you guys been up to the last couple of days?
Oh, man.
How's the bunny, dog?
Dude, check this out.
He got back from his little vacation, too.
We bought his slippers because...
you don't want to take him to Fred Silver's house?
We couldn't take him to with us.
Oh, sorry about
we
that.
We boarded slippers, right? She's a rabbit. We boarded her.
To her. A dame.
In this place where the lady keeps, she lives in the house, and she keeps rabbits in one room, bro. Rabbits and animals. So as soon as we get there, man, she's never been running a rabbit. She goes,
stop.
Let that rabbit know what's up, man. It's my territory now.
Gangster bunny.
So then that rabbit leaves. Another rabbit shows up named Gordo. So the lady who's watching a rabbit while we're in Chicago. She's sending us texts how she's doing.
That the picture of that big-ass rabbit?
Yeah. And we see her, and then Gordo is petting her. She's all happy. She's like in rabbit summer camp. And then she had a crush on this big, fat cat.
Shut up.
Fat boy. Gary.
Gary, dog. Gary Busey.
Gary was declawed by her previous owner. She's a rescue cat. So he has no fucking claws, but he can't scratch nobody.
Nothing like that, because I heard they only do the front ones because they use the back
for,
ones to
they
fight.
They do those for Ringling Brothers, also for the lions in a circus.
Oh, really? I didn't know
that.
That
was full of party to death.
Yeah, well, the reason, they actually cut into the bone so they don't grow out no more, right? Yeah.
They cut it off, man. So they can't claw nobody, bro. She'll bite.
But she can't fucking couch no more.
No, so they do that. I saw videos of slippers. Running around, bro, like she's in summer camp, bro.
Having fun?
But when we brought her back, she was all sad.
Shut up, dog. No more homies, fool.
No more homies. She didn't say goodbye.
Are you serious?
Yeah.
Did she stomp when she got back home?
Hell yeah.
No more binkies or what?
Not for a while.
Damn, fool.
No more pets. But she barely started kissing us again today.
She's asking for some more play dates, dog.
More play dates, bro. Yeah, but Chicago was jam fun in Chicago. You went to go see your family, right?
Yeah, on Sunday, dude.
We hooked up with this fool that gave Rodrigo a haircut in Chicago back in the day, 12 years ago.
Sam, fool. 12 years ago, yeah.
Wow.
That was 04, right? Or 03.
That felt that mean ass beard with a gray beard.
Huh? Hell yeah, he's letting those fucking little canas fly, dog. All gangster, Mexican to the bone, representing, fool, with a big old cinto, piteo.
He had the big old WWE Intercontinental
That's a
champion
mean Mexican
gold
belt, dude. Hell yeah, fool. And all just all like.
And some
dude.
Fucking leather boots, cowboy boots, huh?
Hell yeah, like you were saying, dog. Oh, these fools be representing out here, huh? The Mexican fools. They got to, dog. They're far away.
Representing, man. Oh, man. We went to, Lisa and I, we went to this vegan Mexican restaurant owned by Mexicans, bro.
On Sunday?
All Spanish people were in there. It was delicious, man. They made carnitas, and that shit tastes like carnitas, bro.
They got the textures and everything, you're saying?
They got the texture and the meat going.
Fuck yeah, dude.
What they did, well, you know how carnita has some fat in it?
Yeah, yeah. That little
they added a little piece of noodle in it. Like an egg noodle or something, whatever, inside the meat. And I don't know how they do that, but they made it stick, soaked into it. It tastes like cueritos with a green sauce.
A little bit of fat type taste.
And they had green chili pozole.
Yeah, you said that shit. How was that, dude?
Good, but I like red better.
Yeah, dude?
Yeah.
I've never had green pozole, though.
I had a big quesadilla. I got a quesadilla, but didn't eat it, bro. I took it with me. I still ate it the next day.
Hell yeah, dude. What'd you guys drink over there, fool?
We drank, they had horchata, but I had a shake.
Okay.
But at Chicago Diner, that place was bomb, man.
Fuck yeah, dude.
Stuff. It was Quesadilla La Reina del Sur.
La Reina del Sur.
Yes. It was like in the tip of Lincoln's Park and some other neighborhood. Bucktown.
Bucktown. Because we went to both Chicago Diner locations, huh?
Yeah.
Hell yeah, dude.
I crave some of that shit right now, man.
Fuck yeah, dude. I think we just like, hey, you know what's bad? The bomb as hell, though, I thought was the best thing ever, dude, were those poutine fries, dog.
Oh, yeah.
That with the gravy, dog. It's like, dude, it wasn't even. It
poutine
tasted,
fries. Cooper comedian, shout out. You know what's about poutine fries?
It didn't taste like vegan. It tasted like real, dog.
Poutine fries they eat in Canada. I don't know where else they eat them at, but man, it's like just like fries or tater tots with gravy. And cheese little curds inside, or cheese sauce.
Well,
sometimes they have bacon.
Well, you said the ones over there in Toronto are the ones that have the cheese curds in there. These ones didn't. That's the only thing that we're missing.
It was still good, huh?
I never had. Oh, that shit was bomb, dog.
For yesterday, I went to Doomies, bro.
Oh yeah, you
guys. That fucking Torah vegan jalapeno poppers.
How are they right
Delicious,
there?
Delicious, bro.
Really full.
Fucking good.
Forget about it, stuff.
Yeah, and I had a what you call it? I had the patty melt, fool. Rye bread with grilled onions, stuffed an island, cheese, and meat, vegan meat.
I thought I was back in the
deli. It tasted like what I used to love, bro. The Jack in the Box double cheeseburger supreme, I think. Bacon cheeseburger supreme.
Oh, when it came out?
Remember that shit?
Fuck yeah.
It was a rye bread, crunchy, with two pieces of meat, with white cheese and bacon on it, bro. And all you gotta do is dip it in ranch.
Fool, I would tear one of those up, fool.
Right now?
Curly fries.
Yeah.
I have to be hardcore stone. Fool, curly fries, a big ass root beer, fool, and jalapeno poppers, dog.
Jack in the Box?
Yes, fool.
Fool, you forgot the tacos, dog.
I would probably eat a little taco too, dog. With one eye open, all high.
Lisa used to go. Yeah, man. Last
those
night
tacos
I was.
Are good too, though, dog.
After all that food I ate, well, I ate that and, I also got a little salad, bro, because I need some roughage.
Dick, I got to get my greens
in. I got some salad, and Lisa got the poor boy shrimp sandwich. It was good.
The poor boy? Hell yeah.
And I actually got like this thing that looked more like a Jack in the Box Jumbo Jack.
How was it, though?
It was good.
Hell yeah. Though. As long as, dude, I think.
And he had chili fries. And those chili fries, I'm telling you, I don't know if you ever had chili fries at Little League.
Oh, please.
They taste like that, bro.
Please, dog.
Little League chili fry and burrito were good, huh?
They used to be called chili boats, dog.
Chili boats is fucking
fuck, dog. That shit's good, dog. All that fucking food. But you know what, dude? Even in the vegan element, dude, that shit's made right, dude. It's fucking bomb.
Yeah, so I ate all that shit, bro. I was almost
I was at a Dodger game, man. Left Field Pavilion.
Oh, and I took a tour of a silver cake home.
Ah, hell yeah. I seen that shit. You guys split
fool,
it, dog.
There something that you got to look up. If you guys want to look it up, it's called Princess Cake.
Princess cake.
Princess cake. And it's just a regular white cake with this yellow fondue or fondant. I don't know what they call it, but it's like this plastic frosting they put over it. It's frosting.
It's covered.
It's covered. It's blue. It's green, light green. But the inside of the fucking cake, it has cream filling, like mm-hmm. custard, in one layer, and the other layer is like raspberry frosting or something. It's like raspberry or strawberry frosting.
So those three little layers on
yeah,
one
bro,
on top.
Princess cake, bro. Princess
that's
wants,
bomb, dude.
You can't have your cake and eat it too, bro.
Give me a slice.
So I'm thinking of getting a slice like that, bro, just to take it with me to San Jose because we're driving.
Oh, hell yeah, dude. Road trip, dog.
Road trip, man. Don't forget
it's
about
been a
those
while,
shows, man.
The last one was Visalia and all that shit.
Also, bro, I killed it on that show, bro. I didn't say I killed it, but I had fun. Superstore on NBC.
Oh, fuck yeah. You did a return. You recorded 3 days last week, right?
I recorded 3 days, bro. It was fun. I was nervous, but everybody was cool, bro.
That's what's
I
up.
I blended
bro.
In.
Perfect, bro.
I thought I was going to be one of their characters, you know, because their characters wear the beige pants and the blue vest, and then they look like Walmart or Target workers,
mm-hmm.
but they wear blue. It's called Cloud 9 Superstore on NBC. Fool, they gave me a maintenance outfit.
Hell yeah, dude.
So I was wearing a different outfit. I was wearing a blue, dark blue. I look like a fucking technical, bro.
Tight, dog. I see writing in a character for you in the future, you know?
Yeah. Oh, so, man, so that'd I think I'm going to get a, I'm going to shoot again on September 22nd.
That's what's up, fool.
So, yeah, man, so I got
you're a star, bro.
Co-starring, bro. My name comes out in the back.
You see, dog? Good on
so
all those auditions, fool.
That was fun. I ran into Trenton, bro.
Yeah, he that fool messaged me on Instagram, dog.
Yeah, man, Trenton Stewart.
And you did that snap with that fool, dog.
Yeah.
He didn't believe you, huh, fool?
He didn't believe me,
what
bro.
What the fuck, dog?
Yeah, man, but he worked as a security guard. Yeah, man, he worked in the security 3 years.
What you doing here, brother?
Still acting, you know. He's getting back into stand-up, you know.
Uh-huh.
Doing his thing. For running, it was fun, man. There was a lot of cool people that I was working with. And a lot of good food there at craft service, too.
Hell yeah, I bet, dog.
I took a lot of juice and lemonades home.
Who wants a bagel?
Hell yeah, bro.
Filling up that backpack, dog.
Fill it up, bro. All the waters, apples.
Hell yeah, dude.
I'm starting my own craft. I'm taking my own craft service to San Jose, bro.
Hey, fool, when you did the role, did it do the role just on the script, or did they add more to it, too, to your character?
I did the role. I did the way it was said in the script, but then later on, I started changing stuff because they do a lot of improvisation.
Uh-huh.
The people who shoot that show are the same people from The Office.
Fuck yeah, dude.
So just added what I could, bro.
And they let that shit stand?
Yeah.
Fuck yeah, dog. That's what's up, fool.
It was cool, man. A lot of the people. So before I went to go shoot the show, I made sure I watched the show. So I watched the whole show, dog.
Did your research.
Did my research, bro. I had watched it before,
uh-huh.
but I watched the pilot in four episodes. So when I went to go before I went to go shoot the show, I saw the rest of the season. So when I got there, bro, I really know how the actors' characters are.
Mm-hmm.
So I could be familiar with them. So
hell yeah, dog.
So I acted like a guy who never comes out of the dungeon, you know? Because you never see, like, when you go to a department store, you don't see, like, the maintenance guy.
Hell no, dude.
You see the maintenance guy, bro. There's going to be some problems.
The AC's down.
Hey, the shitter's out. I don't even know what am I? Am I a warehouse guy? Am I a maintenance guy? Or maybe they have a fucking auto mechanic service at the place, like Sears?
You're a technician.
Whatever it is, bro, I'm happy to be on board.
Hell yeah. Well, that's fucking tight, though, dog.
Hell
another
yeah.
Credit for the tube, you know? Keep that SAG insurance.
Yeah, going. Man. So look out for me, man, on the new season, second season of NBC's
Superstore?
Superstore.
Fuck
also,
what up?
George Lopez is shooting his show, The Comedy Get Down.
Hell yeah, dog.
They pitched it and they bought it, bro.
Hell yeah.
I'm still trying to pitch mine, bro. But I'm already buying stuff now.
Hell yeah. But he busted a retweet on you for your special.
Yes.
And he mentioned also mentioned something about you slipping in there too, though.
Yeah,
right?
Bro, I'm gonna play a character, bro, that shows up backstage.
Get
after
out of here, dog.
I play a character that on George Lopez show with Cedric and DL Hewley, Eddie Griffin, Charlie Murphy. It's just them backstage, what they do offstage, like George Lopez going to meetings or getting in trouble. So I'm probably gonna play a guy that gets weed for them.
Oh, hell yeah, dude. That's fucking
I'm
gonna
go what's up, George, man? I know the fucking after party over there, bro. It's gonna be tight.
Fuck yeah, dog. That's what's up right there with the big dog, fool.
Hell yeah, bro.
Right now.
So that's tight, man. So look out for me on that show, the Eric Andre show.
Oh, hell yeah.
I show up with no t-shirt. It's gonna be fun. Amber, I show up on an episode with Amber Rose and Tucos from Breaking Bad.
Hell yeah. One thing, how was it filming with Amber Rose, dog?
It was good, bro.
So it was good, bro.
She smells like lotion.
And she have a big ass, dude.
I didn't know that, bro. I was sitting behind her. But she wears real high heels, so I guess when you wear pumps, it accentuates your ass, I guess.
Real pretty, too, huh?
She's bald, though, bro.
Dick. This will die. Put a wig on that, bro.
I can't. I'm like George Costanza, bro. She's bald, eh? You're bald, yeah. But I know I am bald, eh? Right now, man. I don't know, man. I don't know.
Because there's a scene, though.
She had her own show. I'm Sully McCullough. Right, Sully McCullough, a guest on her show. He's the writer for that show.
Hell yeah, dude. I've seen his little Instagram pics.
I haven't watched the show, man. I don't have cable.
Neither have I.
But I've been watching American Greed.
This fool, dog. Lies from the Admiral.
Hell yeah, bro. Watching that show, man. Poor old white people, man. Giving away thousands. Hundreds of thousands.
Getting jack, fool.
Jack.
I don't understand how you can go through your whole life.
Shit, poor people, we lose our money at lotto tickets.
Dick, you make all this money to the end to give it away, and like, dude, they don't even jack you with a gun or nothing, dog. It's just a lie. Donate money, fool, and then they get your fucking credit card.
But it ain't the guy that's doing the Ponzi scheme that's doing the stealing. By that time, you know, he already, it's like, I'm already involved in a Ponzi scheme, but I don't know I'm involved in a Ponzi scheme with another dude. But here I am telling you, hey, man, blah, bro, I already made some money because he did give me some money. Every month he's giving me a little bit of money to keep me going. But then I tell you, nah, bro, for reals. So that you tell you, you go for it. He's giving you money. But then down the line, everybody's getting robbed. You know what I mean?
For little amounts, right?
Little amounts.
And it all adds up, dude.
It's better not to believe that you're going to get a fucking 50% return on $100,000.
Fool, it's unheard of, dude. Even like, dude, like a 7%
Even if you return. Loan that money to a dope dealer, it ain't going to come back that much.
Fuck no, dog.
It might not come back at all.
Only a loan shark, fool.
That shit's illegal, right? Dog. 50% back on your return.
Come on, fool. That's insane, dog.
He thought they were getting dividends of 55%. Meanwhile, he's getting blowjobs in the Bahamas. And burning hundreds.
Like nothing. Nah, that's bullshit, fool. What's up?
Those fools are just smart, huh?
Well, yeah. Well, dude, I think it's the whole fast-talking thing, and they make you feel comfortable, but then you go look at your bank account, and that shit got swooped on, dog.
Yeah, man. They took me down like that.
Dude, just like how motherfuckers leave their debit card to pay bills and shit, and sometimes they overtake more, dog, and before you know it, fucking you got your ass scammed, dog.
Crazy.
Fuck yeah, dog. What else is cracking, bro?
What else is cracking, man?
You haven't been to a Dodger game in days.
Haven't been, but I'm wearing a Dodger shirt, so.
That makes up for it, fool.
The Dodgers are in first place, bro.
Hell yeah, fool. They fucking got a...
So the Blue Jays, I think.
They beat San Francisco yesterday, dog. They've been on fire the last couple games.
Also, man.
What's up?
Rory's brother-in-law showed up to the Chicago
show. Oh, yeah, dude. Fuck yeah, dude.
That was a tight-ass shirt they had, huh?
Oh, yeah, the memorial shirt.
They had a Rory Hill memorial shirt with like a Cub jersey. And they said, rest in peace, Rory Hill. And then the side of the sleeves, it said, what's up, fool?
They had a little hashtag. That shit was tight,
that
dude.
Was tight. Well, shout out to Mikey O.
Hell yeah. Papa.
Mikey O hooked it up, man.
Making it happen in Chi-Town, dude.
4 sold-out shows.
Hell yeah. Fool. Chi-Town's finest right there, dog.
And then we went to you want to take the best picture in Chicago?
That was a good scene, dude.
We went to this place called Del Campo Tacos. Del Campo Tacos. And on the lake in Chicago, and this place, man, has some bomb ass tacos. I had one of the best bean burritos with rice I ever had.
So they have a bomb ass Chicago dog and a sausage dog.
It's funny, man. Let me tell you about this place, Del Campo Tacos, and I hope I'm saying it right. Mikey O told her that they told his people not to open up a taco stand in that area, in that part of the lake, and they said, why not? So they said, wow, if you want to sell tacos under there, you got to open up you got to sign up for a 20-year lease. So they fucking, orale, man, 20-year lease, no problem.
Fuck it.
So they did sign a 20-year lease, and let me tell you, man, no one around there yet is selling food but them. So they're raking in that feria, bro.
Oh, hardcore food.
And they sell raspados, they sell fucking mangoneadas, pretty much anything you can buy in Boyle Heights. You can buy it there.
Hell yeah. It's like a little mini supermercado, dog.
and they got Chicago dogs, man. What's the difference between a Chicago dog and a Guadalajara dog?
Well, Chicago dog is going to have the little peppers in it. It's going to have a slice of tomatoes. It's going to have a...
onion?
Yeah, chopped onion, but it's also going to have a pickle slice in there. And then it comes on that bun with a little black little dots. A little, I don't
poppy
know
seeds?
I don't know if they're poppy seeds. They're like pepper seeds, dude. And it's long. So it's like, it's not a sausage, but it's long, dude. So that's a Chicago dog, dude. It's bomb. And they have that relish that's really super green, dude. And that's a Chicago dog.
Also, man, yeah, we had that hot dog, and we were in Tucson, Arizona, and we had what do we have? We had the Sonora dog, bro.
Oh yeah, I ate
Tell
one of those.
Tell them about the Sonora dog.
The Sonora dog is kind of like a bolillo type bread, but it's not. But they open it, they cut it in half, and then they put a wiener in there, of course. But they put beans, they put mayonnaise, they put a pico de gallo. And then, and that's a Sonora dog, dude. And it's actually really, really, really bomb and delicious.
Oh, Father Grazer.
So here's our guest, ladies and gentlemen, Father Greg Boyle. Yeah. Yes, sir. Awesome.
So, the first time I had a Sonora dog when I was a kid, man, in Sinaloa, it was just like that, bro. A bread with a little boat. They cut it in half.
Yeah, totally.
And they put a mayonnaise and then ketchup. And the hot dog with the bacon inside was pico de gallo. Delicious.
Oh, yeah. I forgot about the bacon and the beans, too.
Where you been?
On the freeway.
What's up, fool? Rodrigo Torres in the house.
What's happening, Felipe?
Oh, man, we have a special guest here tonight. All our guests special. Are special, but we have a guest here all the way from Boyle Heights. Father Greg Boyle in the house, or G-Dog, prefers to be called.
Yes, sir.
Whatever you call me is fine.
How you
hey,
doing?
Sorry I'm late.
It's okay, man.
I had to park in another zip code.
You're on Mexican time, man. What time the show start? 12:30? I'll get here at 1.
Awesome. How you doing?
I'm good.
We just were talking about food that we had in Tucson, Arizona, and Pueblo, because it's lunchtime right now. I've had Chicago dogs, but Chicago dogs, I've had them before back in the day when I was eating meat, was this real, real, real green relish.
That's the one I'm talking about, yeah. And that's what makes it a Chicago dog.
Yeah.
It's almost like green like that, like your glasses case. No, turquoise.
So you don't eat meat?
No, I'm vegan now. People don't believe me.
Serio?
Yeah.
Wow. I can't believe that.
I know, man. I try to eat at Homeboy Cafe.
Homegirl.
Homegirl Cafe.
You can be vegan and eat there.
Yeah?
Yeah, yeah. They got a lot of stuff.
Los tortas de frijoles. So I was Father Greg Boyle, man. I grew up knowing this man when I was a... But a kid at catechism, when there used to be this mean sister named Sister Alice.
A mean sister.
We talked about her earlier.
From Belgium, remember? Yeah.
Yeah. I thought she was Latina.
No, she was Belgian.
She just looked, had dark hair.
Yeah. They were all Belgian.
I thought she was mean, bro. Yeah.
She had to lay down the law.
I wasn't that involved. I don't really know that side of the tracks.
How did you get
mean nuns? I only know knucklehead gang members.
Yeah, we have a lot of guests on our show that knew you. Like we had Paul Blunt. Paul Blunt, what's his name? Paul Hunt. Paul Hunt. He wrote a book.
Blunt.
No, it's Paul Hunt. I was still thinking about the Sonora dogs.
Like little Blunt.
No, it's Paul Hunt. He wrote that book about Aliso Village.
Oh, yeah.
He's a tall black kid,
that's
like
right,
6 foot
yeah.
five.
Yeah.
We had Fabian Doria here.
Deborah.
I always say Doria. Why do I say Doria all the time? Deboria.
Deborah.
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 Oh, my God.
We had Fabian Deborah here.
¿Qué hacemos contigo?
What
We're
is
trying to get
on?
Chaka Khan, but he never called us back. Chaka.
Chaka.
I saw him the other day. He came in to... Visit. Yeah.
Maybe we should email him by spray paint, bro. Put it on the wall. And that's funny. We're talking about graffiti on the way on the way back home, and how some graffiti is art, and then some people just write on street signs. And I was telling Rodrigo, yeah, man. I remember one time I got off on the wrong exit, bro. I got off on Chaka Avenue.
Representing, dude.
So what's up, Father Greg, man? Long time no see.
Yeah, it's been a while.
Yeah, so how did you show up to Boyle Heights?
Oh, I was assigned there.
But this you're from Santa Monica, right?
No, I don't. I grew up real close to here, to this studio where we're currently. So what year were you born?
I was born in 68.
My God, your ass is old. Okay, no?
Get in there.
So 84 was when I arrived at Dolores Mission. So how old were you then?
84, I was in 7th grade.
Because it was
14, 15.
Because remember, when I got there, I was handed this youth group.
Yeah, you were the part of the youth group.
Yeah, so you were part of that.
Yeah.
You weren't too young for that? No. And, you know, your sister and brothers. And then I came back as pastor. I came back in 85 again, the summer. And then I came back as pastor in 86. So you were whatever you were, 16, 17. Yeah. Yeah. But I was assigned there, you know, to run the place. Pico Gardens, Aliso Village.
And that was probably at a time when it was really banging at that time, right?
Not right at that moment, but 88 is when stuff started. So 88 to 98 was really kind of the decade of death. Now we're kind of going back to it again. I have a funeral tomorrow. I have a funeral next week.
Wow, you have a funeral every week.
I've had one every week.
And is it starting to pop off again?
Yeah, although four of these were killed by cops. So I've had more gang members killed by cops. I've buried more gang members killed by cops in the last 2 years than killed by other gang members.
Wow.
But you don't really hear about that too much.
No, you don't.
I just heard about it right now.
Yeah, yeah.
The first time I saw, like, kind of crazy violence in the projects, I think you were not there probably yet. It was probably, like, 79, 1980.
Really?
During, remember when, I was talking about Drigo, you know, but I was talking about Drigo. There's a memorial for him in San Francisco, like, there's a couple of people that still have posters of him. It was a communist guy during the Red Flag days.
Yeah.
When he's communist, he used to come to the projects.
Yeah, but preach. What was the guy's name?
David. David Perez, I think his name was.
Oh, uh-huh.
He was Latino, but I don't know. I thought he was white at the time.
Right before the Brown Beret days, around the time those
yeah,
days?
Yeah, they were communists. They used to come to the projects, and they were like 25 deep. They used to carry these flags.
And that was remember the Casa de Carnalismo? Yeah. You may be too young for that, but that was on 4th Street. And it was right behind, you remember the hotel on the corner of 4th and Glass? Well, so that was like the big, let's get all the kids in the projects to, I wasn't there yet, but I've heard about it. Yeah.
That guy got stabbed to death right there. And I was like, damn. And then they arrested all the Red Flag guys, but everybody got away.
Damn.
And I was like, oh, my. We had just came out of Pecan Park. We were in a little banana seat by going, whoa. Y'all want to see a dead body?
Yeah. I heard about those days, but that was before my time.
But then when you were in the youth group, it was cool because you used to take us to cruising. Or I told you, we live in West Hollywood.
That's right. So we get in the van and. Because you guys had never gone to, we'd go to the beach, we'd go to, remember we would go to the Bonaventure Hotel?
Yeah, just walk around.
We'd park and then you just go walk around, take the elevator, that the glass elevator, you know, and that was.
And wave.
That was a big trip.
Or take some nuts from the bar.
That's right.
You can actually form a date out of it, right?
That's funny, man. I was wondering why I like doing that, but I thought it was you Tecos over there. We used to go there, bro, get on the elevator and go up and down. They had a Carl's Jr. there, too.
You told me you went on a date one time, but you went to the L.A. Public Library because it has that big old escalator or whatever, and it's like, if the date lasts longer, go to the Bonaventure.
That's right.
I think of everybody there. I took Isaac there. I took my son.
Sweet, dude.
So you have good memories.
Yeah, I have good memories. So you have 4 funerals coming up?
Yeah, no, I've had them this week, this past 2 weeks.
Off in a housing project store where I grew up? Or out Boyle Heights?
Boyle Heights, yeah. The east side, really, you know.
East side?
Yeah.
They don't show the east side too much in the news, huh?
No. You know, well, we just had this kid, 14-year-old, who was killed by the police, so I have his tomorrow. But that made the news, but just because of his age, you know.
And what happened there?
He was writing on the walls, and they chased him. And then the story that you hear on the streets anyway was he had this old gun, which they showed in the paper, really old, kind of crazy-looking old gun. Yeah, I mean, really old thing, you know. And he took the gun, and he threw it on over the fence, and it hit a wall and went off. And the cops opened up fire and killed him. So he definitely had a gun, but he, but that's sort of the story. If you saw this gun, which they showed, you'd kind of go, yeah, well, that sort of makes sense. That's probably what. And a 14-year-old isn't going to turn around and start shooting at the cops. He's 14 years old. He's just writing on the walls, and in case he gets finally to catch him, he doesn't want to be caught with a gun. You know how that works.
And he's scared too.
Yeah, yeah. So that one's a tough one. But they've had some protests and things there.
On your book, you wrote about the book Father Gray and the Homeboys.
I didn't write that. That's Celeste Freeman.
Celeste Freeman, yeah.
Yeah.
But you wrote another book too that I
called
did read.
Tattoos on the Heart.
Yes.
Did you read that?
Yeah. You signed it for me.
I did.
Right after Last Comic Standing.
Oh, good. Good. I'm glad you read it. Thanks.
And
it's from stories from back in the day.
Yeah, some of the stories. And I didn't know that your first one was a 14-year-old.
My first funeral?
Yes.
I can't remember how old he was.
A twin.
But he was a twin. That's the only thing I remember. Yeah. Rafa and Robert. His brother was Robert.
Yeah.
Yeah. The cuates. We just all called them cuates. Yeah. And so, and how they were identical twins, you know. And so even their mom couldn't tell them apart, you know.
Wow, dude.
But it was, I've never seen twins quite like that.
Same teeth, too.
Really?
Yeah. Everything. Yeah. Yeah.
They threw the same.
Yeah. That's right, too. Yeah. Yeah, that was back in 88.
Yeah. That was back in the day when I used to hang out with a guy named Pepino. Remember that guy?
No.
Pepino, bro, he used to just walk around, bro, selling pepinos, and then weed on the side.
All green, huh?
Yeah.
That's right. Get your greens over here.
It was all green, bro, like a Hollenbeck Park, bro.
He's
but Pepino's all the time, bro, no matter what.
Pepino's are bomb, dude.
You wouldn't recognize that place now because it's not, you know, obviously it's all gone.
I know the project is all gone,
yeah.
Man.
Yeah.
I remember before, man, it was like, God damn. It was bad, huh?
But there's nothing there even that you remember, you know?
No,
what's around? Like even the hotel that was on the corner of Fourth and Glass, that's the tech center. The corn factory is there. You know, remember that? The corn factory in the back?
Yeah.
What did they make there? You don't make corn.
I don't know what they made, man. Just rats came out.
Yeah.
They used to go into the projects.
Look,
I don't know what they made, man.
What were all those factories back there? I never knew exactly what all that stuff was.
I just know that some of them have folders. Pico and First Street. Watermelon over on 6th Street. Toy Factory in China, right there on China. The China store.
And there was El Pato. Remember that on
that
Mission?
That place dunk everything, man.
And has that place always been there?
El Pato's been there for a long time.
Never hired anybody from the projects.
Really?
I don't know. I never hired me.
And then Ace Beverage. That was all the
Budweiser,
beer
bro.
Place. Yeah.
A couple of guys got jobs there.
That's one of your friends that you did that show for. That
Yeah. Gilligan, I call him. His name is Guillermo or Memo. Yeah, a couple of guys that got jobs there. William was worked there.
Oh, yeah, William.
Rose, brother.
That's right, yeah.
He was working there. And then another guy that used to live upstairs, up on the hill, he was working there as a manager, and he booked me to do a comedy show. So when they did comedy in the daytime.
Yeah, dude.
Yeah, carne asada, good
all
food.
All their employees.
It was fun.
That's awesome.
So what? So what's changed your mission to work with gangs?
Well, I was pastor and I was bearing kids, and there were, as you remember, you know, there were 8 gangs at war with each other during the time you were growing up there.
And they all lived in the same, like it was between a 1-mile radius.
Yeah, although you're where you lived, of course you had guys from one gang who sort of claimed that turf, but you also had guys from another gang who would live there. And then Aliso had, you know, 5 gangs. The extension had 2. It's not like that now, but you start bearing kids, and so you, what kind of choice do you have, you know? So you start to deal with it. So we started a school. Did you ever go to our, you never went to our school. By
no.
Then you were too old. And
yeah.
Yeah, so that was the school we started across
Saya,
the street.
Right?
It was, first it was called Saya, then it was called Dolores Mission Alternative. But it was on the 3rd floor, so I gave the boot to the nuns, you know, who lived there. And then... So I called them all together in the living room. I said, hey, would you mind, you know, moving out? And we could have a school for gang members. And they said, sure. The very nuns that tormented you when you were a mocosito. And so then that was the first thing we did was we started a school. So all the gang members came to the church property. And that was tough. That was a tough school. I had teachers last exactly 3 minutes sometimes. I had a principal lasted one day. And after that, he changed his number. I never could get a hold of him.
Damn.
No, it was 93 fights a day. It was rough. That one was tough because that was all gang members from the projects going to school with their enemies. So trying to keep them from fighting was really tough. And then we had probation officers. Remember Mary Ridgway and Tuchek? Yeah. And they used to always meet there. That was always tough every Friday at the church, at the school. So I had to kind of stand guard there and make sure everybody behaved. So then we started jobs and graffiti removal. We built the child care center.
You started the bakery right next door, huh?
Right across the street, yeah.
That empty lot.
Yeah, so that was 92. That was right after. Remember when the unrest and everything exploded? Yeah. And then, and that's because Ray Stark, who had $500 million, who read an article, and people were asking me in the LA Times, how come the projects didn't explode? And at that point, we had 60 gang members from different gangs who were working. And they sort of had a reason to get up in the morning and a reason not to gangbang or ignite the projects. So he called me in and he said, what should I do with my money? And I said, buy this bakery across the street. Do you remember that bakery?
Yeah.
Yeah, so there was an
old... Third Street and Boyle.
That's right. And an old guy named Vic, I think his name was. And he made only one kind of bread, which is this Russian-Lithuanian brown bread or something. And the day, a couple days before, he had come to me and said, hey, you want to buy this bakery? I said, why and with what money, you know? And then all that stuff happened. And then I said, well, why don't you buy the bakery? I thought it would be perfect. So... It was tough because it was located in a certain gang turf, as you well know. And once they were there, they could bake bread together. Nobody tripped. But getting to the bakery sometimes was difficult because you had to cross into enemy territory to get there. So that was... if I had to do that one over again, But what could I do? You know, it was... There it was. It had ovens. Why not? You know? And now, since then, we go... No, we're our current... Headquarters is in Chinatown. It's way away from people's neighborhoods, you know.
There's a homeboy also in the airport I passed by too.
That's right, American Airlines, yeah. The problem with that is...
You can't hire cholos.
They can't hire any None of them.
They can't pass the
TSA.
They can't pass it.
The clearance.
So what happens sometimes is because it says homeboy and people know homeboy and people go, well, I'm going to wait in long-ass line to get my coffee. And then they get up there to the front... And they go to these señoras and...
You guys, you know Father Greg, okay?
No, exactly.
they don't know.
They congratulate them, say, hey, I'm proud of you. Nice going. They go, I'm not a cholo.
That happened to me. That happened one time, man. Hey, I was a girl, and then I was trying to find any signs of that she's a gangbanger. She had no tattoos.
The neck.
I was looking at her hand. Three dots. Her neck, no hickeys, you know. Her eyes, no está desvelada. She didn't worry about nothing.
No eyeliner.
Hell no. She was there happy to be working, bro.
Well, I don't know why they can't just say, oh, hey, thanks. You know, just play the part. I mean, why go, I'm not a gang member? And somebody who told me that said, she said, well, I'm going to go buy my coffee someplace else.
Oh, my God.
So, but that's kind of a branding thing. They you know, they said, can we basically used us to get in?
Yeah.
To get... Then the, but you know, they send us a residual check just like you would get from whatever you would get it from. And you get it, and then, but I wish we could hire homies there.
I know, right?
But they don't, can't pass the security. Once I'm wearing a homeboy shirt here that's embroidered, and I walked in, I was flying, and the security guy said, oh, just go ahead. I go, what do you mean, just go ahead? No, you can walk through without having to do my bags or anything. And he thought I worked at the cafe there. And then he realized that, oh, shoot, you know, he could lose his job for just telling a regular citizen to walk through. So he said, don't tell anybody I just said that. I go, I won't. Your secret's safe with me.
There's like a picture of you two with Titi and all those guys.
Oh, yeah.
It's like in Meadow and Hong.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah. Chino. Yeah.
We had his sister... His sister, on the podcast here, too.
Oh, really?
We had Melanie. Milani.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, we get a lot of people in the podcast, man. We had Kip Ross, Baby Bash.
Mellow Man Ace.
But you're our biggest guest we ever had.
Really? You mean fast, yeah. Or?
No. Well, most important to me.
Yeah.
Because I always tell that story how you helped me out. I think I said it on Comedy Central. On the show This Is Not Happening, how when I was all strung out and I had just bitten that guy's ear off.
Can you hear me now?
It's not funny now, but you know.
Mike Tyson.
Yeah. Before Mike Tyson. Yeah. He's a hack. Yeah, man. No, and you came Mike to the house here. And you sent me to that with Juan... Pastor Juan Higuera?
Yeah, way up
Live in again. Live Recovery again, home.
Yeah. I don't know if that exists anymore.
It still exists. Does it? They still do exist.
Yeah.
We donated money to them when I won Last Comic Standing.
Oh, good.
Yes. I remember you sent me there, man. I was like, whoa.
That was the only place I knew in those days, you know. Now we know a lot more places, but that was good. And it was Retirado.
It was far. It was perfect.
Yeah, so you couldn't be tempted to walk home.
Yeah, or look up at a bus station.
There are no buses.
There were no buses that said downtown LA, so I knew I was stuck.
How long were you there?
A year.
Are you serious?
Wow.
Yeah. I saw a lot of people come in. I saw Lupe come in there, R.I.P., Caveman.
Yeah, Caveman.
Or Scooby. Yeah. Dreamer, he came in there too.
Yeah.
He was there for like 3 months. It was funny when he was there. There was this Armenian guy. I forgot his name, what he was. He was there for being an alcoholic. And he was a jeweler. And when I was checking him in, he had like tons of cigarettes, but he's saying she can't bring that in, so he has to stop smoking. So he's always eating something, right, just to keep his mind on the edge. And Dreamer, and he was receding hairline, but he used to bring his hair from the left side and hide it to the right side,
doing the Trump.
And one time that dude Dreamer, he was like a jokester fool. That fool was making me laugh.
Oh, my God. He's funny.
Batman, check this out, hey. That fool ran, and he flipped his hair over, dog.
You want to do the flop?
That fool chased him all day.
Shut dog. Up, dude.
But he was right. He hasn't smoked in a month, bro. He cut up to him, bro, slapped him in the back of the head. But it was funny, dog.
Oh, I bet, dude.
It was entertaining, eh?
And that whole year that you were out there, how many times did you come home?
I mean, like twice.
Okay.
Yeah, it was strict.
I was hitting, bro. I wanted to hide.
And the other thing is, if you look back on the history there, because you got out just in time.
Yeah, I always say that. I got out just in time. Because when I got out, it was still peaceful.
Yeah.
There was nobody really like, there was drug sales, but they were mainly on the New Aliso side.
That's right.
And it was barely building on the back of the Pico Gardens. It's a 6th Street. It hadn't really moved to 5th Street yet. It was still scattered, you know, but not really.
Its way.
It wasn't controlled.
And the violence wasn't what it was, you know. And then you were there just gone. You were like airlifted out of that community.
I know, man.
You were really fortunate. That was fortunate.
Yeah, man. Thank you.
Because it was really...
I always think about that. Like, I look, because I'm like, I'm watching this, I'm doing stand-up comedy, and I'm watching... via satellite TV at this bar, and I'm not drinking there, but everyone around me is drinking, and they're watching KTLA, and they're knocking down the projects. And I tap somebody on the shoulder. That's my hood right there. They're knocking down. It was Aliso Village.
Yeah,
it was like what they call it, Section One.
Yeah.
Aliso Village. How many people lived there? That's a lot of people, huh?
Yeah, that was
at one time more than 500, right?
Yeah, remember, though, they were higher than your projects. Your projects were just 2 stories. They were 3, 4?
There were 3.
Yeah.
There were 3, and then you go to Aliso, there was one
in
story.
New Aliso.
Then they got a tier with a little gate, and it always smelled like pee over there.
Yeah, that's right.
An old watering hole.
And it was like, over there, man, you had to pretty much be a Jehovah Witness to walk around there safe.
Yeah.
Or walk around there during
Las
Posadas. Yeah.
Yeah.
Because you got to go to the Crips and East LA and Al Capone. So many gangs, bro.
Primera.
You wouldn't know who was who without that magazine Teen Angel.
Identify yourself.
This is before the internet, bro.
Oh, man.
Yeah.
Or you just Father Greg and his 10-speed.
Yeah. It was never a 10 speed. It was
a beach cruiser.
Beach cruiser, yeah. And that happened because I used to steal bikes. So I'd be in Aliso, and of course, you didn't have cell phones.
No.
Or even pagers. And someone would call in Aliso, hey, there's a shooting in Pico Gardens. I'd say, hey, Michael, I'll bring this right back. And I'd take a little trike, you know, one of those, what you call them, banana seat.
Banana seat bikes.
Yeah, and I would race over to Pico, and then I'd come back. So I kept doing that. And then one day, you remember Ruben, Rudy's brother, Ruben?
Yeah.
Yeah. So he was working in the park, and so he calls El Paniqueado and says, hey, there's a fight over here in the at Pecan Park. So I race over there, and they all had, remember the cuate, all the people who ran the park?
Yeah, cuate.
They had a big beach cruiser with a big bow and said, here's your bike. So it was nice. And the very first night, it got stolen. Very first night, it was a summer, so I rode over to in Aliso, and I said, well, I'm going to get a soda or something. And I just left it outside, and boom. Somebody took off with it. And it was a little African-American kid who I could see, but I didn't know who it was. And then I went into Aliso. I thought, if I don't find it now, that bike's gone forever. So I see a guy I knew from the Crips who had just gotten released. And big hello. And I said, hey, dog, do me a favor. Somebody from your neighborhood just checked my bike. He goes, don't worry about it. Stay right here. 10 minutes, it was back. With the kid. I'm sorry, I didn't know it was yours.
That they whip him with a belt. Oh, like, man. Baby boy. You took your belt off, Father Greg.
Go and sin no more. That's what I said.
When I tell the story about me, you helping me out, I always tell people, no, man, there was no homeboy industry then. It was the beginning of Jobs for the Future.
That's right. That's what it was called, Jobs for the Future.
It was the beginning of it.
Yeah, well, that was 88.
88, yeah.
And that's when we would try to convince employers to hire you.
You go door to door.
Yeah.
Because I remember...
Well, we went to the factories first.
They said, no way. But I remember, because I ran into your nephew in D.C. His mother is your sister. Because you got me that job at the Marina Hotel.
Oh, yeah.
When I was 19 years old.
Yeah. And that was my sister who did employment things.
Yeah.
Yeah, wow.
Human resources.
Yeah. What did you do there?
I lasted 2 weeks.
Was this before or after?
Before.
Live Again.
Before Live Again. Before, after I got hooked on crack. I got somebody pregnant, so I needed a job, and I went over there. And I remember doing an interview, and then I was bummed out, right? And then your sister said, come on, Felipe, life is not over at 19. But I was catching a bus over there for 2 weeks. I was lead houseman. I was in charge of all the beds and the linen at night. Not during the day. During the day, there was, like, the cleaning people. But, like, at night after 6, there's only one dude, and that was me. Like, if someone needed a room clean immediately because someone's checking in, I got to go over there and, you know,
Make it clean
the best I can. Not really clean it the way they do it.
Just get it prepped.
I got my scam going there, bro.
Scam.
2 weeks only?
2 weeks.
Wow.
I think it was probably a week, though. I'm not going to be exact.
Give an extra 7 days.
That was my sister, Meg. She got a lot of people jobs back in those days.
That's awesome.
So I ran into his, I think his mother or his aunt. One of your nephews was at a show I did in D.C.
Oh, really?
For the Democratic thing I did.
Yeah.
And Sean. He was there. Sean. Yeah.
Yeah, and that's his mom, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, my Smart brother world, lives huh? out there. My brother lives there.
Yeah. So that's before Jobs, that before was Jobs for the Future.
Yeah, before Homeboy, yeah.
But then when you had Homeboy, I think you had the colors that were red, green, and
that's right.
Yellow.
Originally, yeah, it was...
kind of like the Mexican flag color, yeah, but not really.
Yeah, that's right.
I was watching, I think it was that show, the Larry Sanders show.
Damn.
And one of his writers that he was going to fire showed up with a homeboy.
Oh, is that right?
One of his writers on the show, on the Larry Sanders show, with the comedian, what's his name?
Gary Shandling.
Gary Shandling. When they were getting writers together, he was going to fire one. The guy was going to fire, he was wearing a homeboy t-shirt.
In that OG one, the one that was green and...
Green,
yeah,
it was black.
Yeah.
It was black with a lettering.
Yeah.
Wow, what's that shirt say? How he speaks. And I was going to ask you, as far as your success there in the projects or just in that area alone, it seems like so much, they garner so much respect for you because there's like community activists or so-called leaders and people kind of walk over them because they want to take maybe a little leadership position to help people out.
Yeah.
But is it because you treat everybody as a human being and you understand the culture and more over time you understood it and see what you had to do or what you could do with the little you had?
Well, I don't know. I think people respect you if you kind of walk with them, you know. So I've been there 30 years now. So, and back in those days, you know, there was just, it was different, you know. Walking in the projects, riding my bike in the projects, and you get to know everybody. And then, so, although I have to admit, initially, especially in Aliso, you know, they thought I was a narc. And, and the Crips would always say, "Good afternoon, officer."
Oh.
And it was like, wow, you know. But the Latinos knew I was the priest because some of them even went to Mass occasionally, you know, or at least their jefitas.
The English one.
The English one,
I
yeah.
Just, I was telling Rodrigo that I would just show up for the flyer
the pamphlet and peel out.
The bulletin.
The bulletin. That was my old trick right there.
Look, Rafaela would never fall for that. Well, she knows that scam.
I just hung out with my mom. I took her to New York with me.
Wow.
Yeah, we went. I was working at the Caroline's in New York.
Oh, wow, that's a big.
And then my brother said, my mom wants to go, so we all hung out.
And she had never been.
Never been. Está muy grande. I took her to Coney Island.
Great. Where'd you stay?
We stood at a place called the Yotel in Manhattan. It was what they call in New York, micro loft, but it's really a studio.
micro.
We had a queen bed with bunk beds next to us. So it was a three beds in one room, and my mom had her own room.
Oh, great.
She had a good time, right?
Yeah, it was fantastic, dude.
Yeah.
I also, I've taken my daughter to, when I won Last Comic Standing, I took her to D.C. to do that show.
Yeah.
And we stood in a smaller room, bro.
Are you serious?
Oh, yeah.
He said, oh, yeah.
I kept bumping into her dreams. She goes, "Dad, stop following me." Hey. I'm sorry. It's a small room, man. Sorry to ruin your life. Yeah, so also, when you were in the 80s, you were a couple of the Contras, right? Was that a rumor I started?
¿Cómo que Contras?
No, when you were in El Salvador, in Nicaragua somewhere, Central America.
No. I was in Salvador a couple times during the war, and then I came back.
But weren't you captured?
No.
Google it, bro.
Don't tell these lies on Wikipedia.
No, but there was a thing.
I made you a legend, sir.
There were three priests, myself and two priests, who were called the, what are we called by the immigration? Los Tres Renegados, you know, the
three renegades?
Renegade priests, you know, and, but La Opinión that had a big Los Tres Renegados. And so Harold Ezell, who was the head of the INS in the Southern California region, he didn't like me, Mike Kennedy, and Luis Olivares, who were the two priests over at Placita. Because we remember in the early days, like 88, we declared sanctuary, our church. So undocumented men and women, men slept in the church,
yes.
And women slept up in the convent.
You said that in your book, The Truth of the Heart, when it got so bad, bro. That he was doing service, and then somebody in the audience would go, "Pesta pata."
Yeah, that's right. Yeah.
Oh, man.
Yeah.
It smells like feet in here, right?
Well, we asked them because they were all complaining. They all said, "We're going to go to another church." And so we were kind of talking about it.
Yeah, the whole church, bro, was covered with Border Brothers.
Yeah, at night. Those days, we had 100 men sleep in the church. It's not that much now because now it's like 50.
And yeah, we'd serve them dinner sometimes, wouldn't you?
Yeah. Every night.
Every night, bro. Dinner and sleep in the church, bro.
But like the women in the parish, you know, like your mom and folks, they'd all take turns, you know. Every night they'd feed them, you know. Still to this day.
Are there more people now or less?
No, there are fewer people now because in those days it was like he always said, okay, come on, we'll take another. And now they kind of regulate it.
Screen it.
Only 50, not 51, We always kind of said, there's room for one more. Before, and now they put cots down. In the old days, they would
give
blankets
benches.
On the bancas, you know. Yeah, that was a long time ago. So that was 87, 88.
That's a lot of people, huh?
It's a grip, dude.
But so where did you get this contra idea that I was...
For real,
like I was smuggling guns
by the guerrillas
to the Sandinistas.
I heard they captured you, and they found out who you were, and they released you with a blindfold out of a truck.
That's such a wild
story. I love it.
For real, man, I made you a legend.
Google it.
Wow. And when you got to the neighborhood, did you know what you were getting into? Did you even, like, know that area? I mean, you're from
no.
L.A., but you didn't know anything.
Well, I was just ordained a priest in 84, and then I was going to go to Bolivia, and then they assigned me to the Lord's Mission because it was Spanish-speaking, but I didn't know how to speak Spanish, so I don't know why they assigned me there.
You learned all your Spanish there?
No, in Bolivia mainly.
Okay.
And then I came back and did another summer, then I had to go back and study some more, and then they... assigned me to Santa Clara University, and I kind of didn't want to go there. And I said, how about assign me to Dolores Mission? And as luck would have it, they didn't have any. The pastor had just left. So they
Father
needed
William.
Somebody. No, he was way before.
Father Tom. Father Walter.
No.
I know him.
No. Joe Spieler. Remember Joe?
Oh, shit. Joe, man. Father Joe?
Yeah.
He had that laugh, bro, that when he was mad, he had that laugh that if he was mad at you, he still smiled, but you see, like, a little watery in his eye, like...
He was like
at this. That was Father Joe, bro.
Like
he got mad
man.
Because I climbed up to ring that bell, bro.
That's right.
Nobody rings a bell, bro. I want to ring it.
Well, we did. When I became pastor, they put a rope on it.
Yeah.
And I thought, well, why don't we do it? So they stopped using that automatic one. But then 20 years later... somebody went to ring the bell, and the whole bell came down.
That's sad.
It was
huge. Are you serious?
It almost killed somebody. So then we said, we're not going to do this anymore. So if you go there now, is it there? I don't think it's there. I think they took the whole thing down.
How long has the Lord's Mission been there?
So it's been there about 70 years, but it was a satellite. You know, so that's where it has the name Mission, because it's not like California Missions.
Yeah.
Mission meant it was a satellite. So it was a satellite of St. Mary's, which is up the road on 4th Street. And the people in St. Mary's, that was the high-class area.
Yeah.
And we were the flatlands, you know?
Yeah.
And they didn't want the Mexicans to come up the hill to go to Mass there with the Irish and the other wealthy Chicanos. So they said, well, we're going to give you your own church. So in Pico Gardens was the first one, and they built a little shack. And then 70 years ago, Our Lady of Talpa was going to build a new church. So they said, we'll give you our church. So Dolores Mission is a hand-me-down church. They put it on a flatbed truck 70 years ago.
Wow.
In pieces. And then they anchored it down, which is why, remember the earthquake?
Yeah.
87.
Wheaton Narrows.
Yeah, 87 really did damage to it because it's a hand-me-down church. So we had to have mass in the hall at the... Did you go to Dolores Mission school?
No, I didn't go. I went to Utah and Hollenbeck.
Oh, and Hollenbeck. And after that?
Roosevelt and El Sereno.
Did you graduate from Roosevelt?
No.
So you were there how many years?
I was there till 87.
So that was like how many years there? 2 years?
2 years.
Yeah.
But I did earn my letter in swimming team, bro. We took city champs.
I thought there was it somebody else in your family that was bussed over to... Remember people...
Angel.
The angel went to Pacific Palisades.
Albert and Juan Carlos were bussed to Pacific
Palisades.
And so did Marsha.
So it wasn't you?
No.
How did they get... That's a good gig. That was, you know...
My mom was always looking for the deals, bro, for education.
Yeah.
Keeping an eye out.
Oh, we find out what the free stuff was. Summer camp.
Did you ever see that movie, Crazy Beautiful?
Yeah.
Yeah, so that has that kind of thing where the guy lives in Boyle Heights and he gets bussed to Pacific Palisades.
Jay Hernandez.
Yeah, and he falls in love with the daughter of the...
Kirsten Dunst.
And I'm in that movie.
You are?
Yeah, so when he goes to visit the senator, whoever he is, the father.
Yeah.
He's on the phone. He goes, hey, hang on a second. And he's talking on the phone. And on the wall is a picture of me with some homies who actually worked on that film. And then he hangs up. He goes, well, you know Father Boyle? Yeah. I go, yeah, I do know him. He goes, yeah, he does good work in Boyle Heights. That's my claim to fame, to being crazy beautiful.
I remember awesome. You always had, like, the odd jobs in the beginning, like, for a job for the future. Because I remember myself and Lupe's brother, Jose Lopez, Joe, and Raul and Juan from New Aliso.
Oh,
they
were
from
real nice guys. That's right, yeah.
Real cool guys. I grew up with all these guys. You got us a job at Columbia Pictures, destroyed. It wasn't really destroyed. It ended up being destroyed. They were paying us cash every day. And we were, I think we were like, we were like clearing up the bottom of the studio. We were just breaking pipes. We were taking these pipes away.
Yeah.
It was like in 1990, I think, or 89. Yeah. And I remember that they were paying us every day in cash, man. And at first, everybody was doing a neat job, you know, but then after a while, man, we just went crazy and we just broke everything off and we were done with the job.
Started yanking shit out and stuff.
So it was only like a few days?
It was a week.
Yeah.
A week of good pay, of cash pay.
Yeah.
Under the table.
I don't remember that.
Yeah, that was a good one.
Every once in a while, they would get these things and you'd send
And an
people.
AC install, air conditioning installing in City Terrace.
Really?
Yeah, another job I had.
Who, you yourself or with
Me
somebody
and Joe
else?
And the same guys, oh, really? And Raul and Juan and Lupe Woody.
Oh, Woody, yeah.
And at first we were screwing the unscrewing the whole jack and putting them in. Then after a while, you said, "What? Are they gonna use that metal part now?" So we just started kicking them off, bro. We're kicking one kick. It just all thing came off, and we put the AC on, dude.
One kick. Well,
those AC might have found the future.
Yeah, dude.
Those all kicking the bottom.
Oh my God, did you?
Yeah, that was another job under the table, bro. If you get cut, all you gotta do is go back to church and they pray on it.
Just hold your arm, dude.
That's what we did, and then we also did sometimes where we would send you somewhere. Can you hire these guys? And they say no. Well, will you take these guys?
And you'll pay them.
And I'll pay them, which was that was really
tough. Huh?
Yeah. Because every Friday was payday, and sometimes
come up with
and once I needed $10,000 on Friday, and I had 3 days, and I didn't know how I was going to do it, and I had 60 guys working, and I was preocupado, you know. And some woman comes in, old woman, almost like a bag lady, and she needed to talk to me, and her husband had died, and so she and her son were cleaning the room, and she said, you know, my husband always respected you, and so we found this under the mattress, and it was a brown paper bag. And I opened it up as cash, and she says, I stopped counting at $10,000. It was $12,000.
Wow.
Like 3 days before I was supposed to, I was going to give IOUs.
What a godsend.
Yeah, I mean, unbelievable.
So that church, the Lord Mission, that was started 7 years ago, was started in the flatlands because...
Well, it was that building is there 70 years.
Yeah.
Or no, maybe it was 70, including the Pico Gardens first one.
But it was like, if not really, because I already knew it wasn't really a mission, because San Fernando is a mission.
Yeah. Yeah.
Sierra Madre, that's a mission. They got statues.
San Juan.
Yeah, so it's not a mission.
We're the Lord Missions, but like patas, bro. Yeah.
No good for swamps.
They added an extra ulcer boy for foot powder, bro.
Not even a fountain.
So that church was started because they didn't want, the people with lower with no
in
money.
In the flatlands.
To go up the hill to the real Irish church.
That's
like,
right.
Like Evergreen.
That's right. Well, St. Mary's, which was mainly that, because that was the Heights. Remember Boyle Heights?
Boyle Heights.
Was a ritzy place to live because you had this whole view of the city, which you still do. But in those days, that was pretty swanky, you know, like the original Workman family and all those families that owned big homes, which then became the Hollenbeck home, you know, all that stuff around there.
Workman, by the way, Google him. He had his own street in the valley. Workman was
downtown.
The guy who bought all the land from.
Right. And Boyle was his mother-in-law's, his wife's maiden name.
The old Jewish enclave, right, back in the past?
Well, see, yeah. That's right. Of course, that was Russian flats. So the Russian immigrants first lived there. And then the Sparsa family lived there after that.
Yeah, bro.
Rafaela came in and said, Vete a la. And the Russians took off.
So besides the Lord's Mission, man, like I always knew, like you know, some people say, that woman is good at sales. She knows where the sales at. I was always good, bro, at finding free lunch in the summertime. And remember, how long has that Baptist church been there? Not Foursquare, but the one that's on across the street from the basketball courts.
Oh, yeah. That's called...
Jordan, no?
No, it's called Weller.
Weller.
Yeah, that goes way back. That's a historic... I don't think they can tear it down.
That church, when... I remember when they used to serve my... Nobody really knew, but I knew. But some people knew. They served in the summertime when I was a kid. Breakfast, lunch, and dinner.
You're kidding.
Forget yes. about it, dude.
Wow, I don't even remember that.
They used to have a hot meal, bro, for breakfast, a hot meal for dinner. And I remember I would go there and stand for dinner. I would have to listen to them talk for about 10 minutes.
Oh, yeah.
But it's okay. And I would go there, and I would eat, like, enchilada, bro, in a little aluminum foil. And it was hot meals they were giving it for dinner for all the children.
That's awesome.
Wow, and I don't remember that.
It was me. I would come from Pico Gardens, bro. That's a quarter of a, 3/4 mile.
I'm a traveler.
And I would go to Peak Camp Pool, and I'd come out 3 or 4 o'clock. Oh, dinner in 1 more hour. I'll just wait here. And like, then I would have lunch at that Weller's Baptist Church and breakfast. When I one last come and stand there, I said, man, I should give him a little donation for all the free meals.
Like the Ordained of Boyle Heights over
does
here.
Does it exist? I don't even know if
the church
it's a
is
church,
still there. The
but church, I don't know if they have services or
anything. I don't know. No, they do have church services because I Googled it.
Uh-huh.
And they have them, I guess, a lot of older people show up there.
That was
a
historic,
church.
Historic place that goes way back to the 30s.
Then there's Foursquare Church where
yeah.
Barbara used to sing.
That's right. I don't know if she still does.
Entertainment at its finest.
I remember.
I went to other churches, bro, because I wanted to eat.
You knew where the food
was. I wanted menudo, bro. I go to the Royal Mission, bro.
That's right. You
got the best beans in the city.
Menudo Sundays.
O tardeada.
Yeah. Did you ever used to go to the kermes? Remember the kermes?
Yeah, I went to one.
The big fiesta?
Yeah. I was stuck in jail with that one.
Yeah.
I missed it.
Yeah, they have a little jail for sale for that one where you mess around.
And a dunking booth and a kissing booth and all that bello.
It's awesome. And what drives you to do all this?
Oh, I don't know. God, I suppose. You know. But this is, it's been a great run. And now we're quite large, you know. We're not like back in the day. When,
I know, man.
When
you're not going door to door in that bistro anymore.
Yeah, that's right.
You got a moped.
Yeah. Get him a scooter. Right?
So we're kind of large. So,
because when you started off like
from nothing, right?
Calling people you knew, like yeah. your sister.
Like my sister, yeah.
That's yeah, right. Javier Felipe Esparza. He's 19 and he's reliable. He had a bus pass. So, I was going there by bus.
Yeah. I can't believe I thought you were reliable. What was I thinking? I'm talking about I was naive, man. And tapado.
I know. I will go to the interviews confused with the stuff you said about me. Like, well, if he said you're reliable, and I just look at them in the face and go,
dedicated.
Is that what he said? Then it's okay, right?
If he said that, okay.
Trustworthy, all right, eh? My resume was Father Greg and Big Ron.
Who was Big Ron?
Remember Big Ron?
No.
You don't remember Big Ron? He was a Christian guy.
Where did he work?
He worked for a Christian church, and he was a big, burly, white man.
And you worked for
him? Big, fat hands. No, he bought me my first Bible when I was 14.
So what would he do, come into the projects?
He would come into the project and talk. He was big like Jaws from Moonraker, bro. And like he would just talk to people, and he'll take a bunch of kids to McDonald's, and he'll talk about the Bible, and they'll bring us back. You know, cool guy.
Well, I don't remember him. You were must have a little mocosito. You were young, young, young.
Yeah, man. That when I was working on that movie Duke of Earl.
Do you remember the movie Boulevard?
Duke of Earl.
No, but what was the one that they filmed there? Oh,
Blood In, Blood Out, yeah.
American Me, no?
Not so much.
Blood
no,
In,
no.
Blood Out. Miklo, we had him on the show, too.
Who?
Miklo.
Damon Chapa.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, but, I think.
So were you around then?
No, man. I was in rehab, coming out of rehab when that movie came out.
Because they have great shots of old, what Pico Gardens used to look like.
Yeah.
First playground and that parking lot.
Whenever that movie comes out, you see, we have a real witness here, people. Blood In, Blood Out. When Damon Chapa is Miklo saying bye to his mother, that's where some guy used to live in the archway, and that's where we all used to hang out and play handball.
Right. That's right. Yeah.
Wow, man. So what?
But American Meat didn't. They Ramona Gardens a little bit, yeah. And then
not really the projects.
Not the projects, but that apartment on whatever street that is.
And Boulevard Nights is the wedding at Dolores Mission.
Yeah,
it is a Dolores Mission,
yeah.
Huh?
Yeah,
that's tight.
Very good.
And they had a bunch of cars hopping.
That's
bro.
Right. Yeah,
a lot of the homies were there. Old school, fool.
Yeah,
super
yeah.
old school LA. Right there.
So you don't ever cover the contrast, huh? I've been lying to people. Making stuff
he escaped,
up.
Dog.
Blindfolded from behind the truck.
A couple of people that I met during my comedy, long comedy career now, there's a guy named Joe Barron. Oh, he has a good job. He's from Inglewood, gang. He's from Inglewood.
Yeah.
He has some all his sleeves. He was in juvenile hall. He said you baptize him.
Really?
Yeah, he had a good job now working.
Hey, he made it out of that.
He made it out of that. He's working at Beverly Hills. At a rental car place.
We're for Southwest now.
We're for Southwest
yeah.
now?
Really?
He has tattoos of... He has, all his tattoos are on one sleeve. He always says that I got this side is one story and the other side he has nothing. This is the other story.
Hmm.
He said you baptized him in Eastlake.
At Juvenile Hall, yeah. Were you ever there?
Hell no, man. I was ratting people out.
Nah.
Nah.
I'm pulling that offer suit. Can I talk to you on the side real quick?
I used to pull that offer suit.
I gotta go home tonight, dog.
I got arrested, but I got bailed out one time, and then after that, I got.
You mean as an adult?
Yeah, I got arrested when I was 19. But once I got in trouble, it was deep trouble, man. Where there was like no turning back.
Yeah.
So I just went into rehab, and I don't know how I stayed out, but it's funny, man, how bad it got because I never saw it.
Yeah.
I was lucky.
Yeah.
So it got really bad.
That's right.
It's funny, man. When I was watching, when I was on Last Comic Standing, they asked me, you know, Felipe Esparza, what are you gonna do with the money if you win? And the first thing I said, I'm gonna donate it to a Father Greg Boyle Homeboy Industry. And they showed the Homeboy Industry on NBC.
Yeah.
I don't know if you knew it.
I remember seeing it.
It was crazy, huh?
Rooting for you.
Yeah. Speaking of people in Boston, I know somebody in Boston. I know that woman that used to work for you from Boston.
Kara Gould.
Gould, yes.
Yeah.
She's in Boston.
Yeah.
I'm going to invite her to the show and give her a
feature. Are you going there now?
Yeah, I'm going to be in Boston. September 22nd and 23rd, Rhode Island in Boston. So if you know anybody that wants to go watch.
Yeah. So where in Boston?
Boston Wilbur Theater on the 23rd.
Well, that's a good theater.
And the 22nd, Comedy Connection.
In Rhode Island.
Rhode Island.
Oh, great.
I always follow your story. Like, we had that one time. Actually, I saw you at the airport one time. You were going with the homies to go speak somewhere.
Yeah.
And another time when they didn't let Fabian inside Toronto.
That's right. So we had to send him back to New York City.
To New York
They're
City.
They're strict in Canada.
Strict, oh, yeah. man.
Many times I've tried to do it. You get invited by the government to speak at some conference. And the immigration says, we don't care who invited you. These guys aren't coming into the country. That's happened twice to me.
Twice?
As much as you prepare beforehand, thinking they're going to say, good, you know, but they didn't. So, yeah, Fabian. Can you imagine denying Fabian?
I know, right? So some of the older homies are still locked up, like Stranger.
Yeah.
I forgot his name. He's like...
Danny.
Danny, man. He had a brother named Angel.
Angel How's got Angel? Out. He just got out.
Oh, yeah?
He got out about a year ago.
Good guys.
Yeah.
I run into people like sometimes, like I ran into people from the neighborhood who live in them. And the one guy that you got him a job working in an oil refinery up north.
Yeah.
Cali. Cali.
Speedy.
He came to my show.
Oh, is that right?
Yeah, he came to my show in Pleasanton, yes. That was a guy when they gave me the tequila bottle and I gave it to him.
Oh, okay,
that
guy. Yeah.
Then John Escamilla.
See, he lived in the back, near Second Playground.
Yeah, then John Escamilla showed up at one of my shows in Pleasanton, California.
Yeah, Cata, remember? Cata Escamilla.
Cata Escamilla, bro, the whitest like Mexicans in the neighborhood. They get all the benefits, Father Greg. Remember that? When people get jealous when Father Greg... What happened is, when Father Greg would do the English mass, at 7 or 8 o'clock.
Nine.
At nine, or sometimes at 10 or noon. But if Father Greg Mass in Spanish was the hot ticket, bro. Who would show up early, bro, saving seats. And they will fight to see who's going to walk up with the wine. And
it's always those politics on church.
Always, bro.
Our family's going to do
this. There's always side talking. Ella andaba borracha anoche. You heard it, right?
Oh, of course.
Or like during like las posadas, it was like somebody's house to keep the baby Jesus, and it goes ni cuida los niños y va a tener baby Jesus. Posadas, for real, bro. Like the baby Jesus is gonna be there for the posadas, and the posada, by the way, it's a thing that we do for Catholics. You know, we walk around el nombre del cielo.
Very good. And
For real, bro. I was over there, man, burning a candle, bro, in my hand. But
and then you get the what do you call them?
The buñuelos.
Buñuelos.
Yeah. But see, man, like I said, bro, I was an altar boy, so I knew where the house where the food was gonna be.
Where the champorrado would be.
The champorrado. So we knew that one house says no, another house says no, and the third was a charm. Yes. So since I was hanging out with Father Greg and all these priests, I knew where the house was going to be, bro. So I was already in line, bro, by the time they got there.
With the piñata. Piñata.
I was already in line, dog. I was passing out champorrado wristbands. Yeah. A lot of politics that was started by ladies, you know, who were going to bickering or on the side. Y otra vez en su casa, Father Greg. Or they tell you, how come you're hiring this guy at a job and this guy didn't get a job?
Oh, my God.
So whenever I do a Father Greg's birthday party, I would do a comedy show. And they would always laugh. I said, I'll try to get a job with Father Greg, but they told me I've never been shot before. So I came back in a wheelchair. They said, all right, bro, we're going to give you the keys to the van.
You used to do that, remember? At the office.
Yeah, so Kara Gould, when I met her, she was surprised that a lot of the young homies knew me. So she said, all right. She would take some of the homies to see me at Latino night at the Laugh Factory.
All the time.
Oh, really?
I would give them all tickets, bro. Boom, boom, boom. How many? 30? Here. Brr. And they would all show up deep, bro.
Representing one band.
Good times.
But they're a good audience.
Good audience, bro. Yeah. Chino wanted to be a comedian, bro.
Chino Farm Yahang.
He was so funny, bro. Sometimes I would say, man, could you not yell shit out at me?
He's good. He works in our bakery.
So you started the bakery with that guy who hooked you up. Then it burned down.
Then it burned down in 99.
Then we all got paid. We got the insurance money.
A settlement over here.
But then you moved up to a tortilla company, right? At the inside of Grand Central Market.
That's right.
I used to go there and pass by, man. I used to see the homies work there. And then
we lost so much money on that deal.
They got rid of the liquor store finally there.
Oh, the one right in front.
You know the liquor store that's been there for 100 years?
Yeah.
Done.
Oh, really?
They have a very posh winery now.
Yeah.
Craft beer now.
Yeah. No, it's a fancy place.
That used to be the place to buy cigarette for a quarter.
Singles?
So you lost out on the tortilla factory?
Yeah, we lost a lot of money. We were in Ralph's and stuff, but you can't compete with those big mega. Who are the mega?
Guerrero,
tortilla?
Bro.
Guerrero and Romero. Mission. And so we couldn't keep. So they wiped us out. So we finally just folded that.
So now you just have chips.
Well, we have chips and salsa, that in the Ralph's, and guacamole, I think.
When I saw it, I was like, what?
They're good chips. Actually, people like the chips.
And a lot of people show up to at the cafe. I saw Jim Carrey.
Yeah, Jim Carrey, Jack Black, Vice President Joe Biden was there.
What?
Sweet.
What did he order?
I don't know what he had. But when I came back, I wasn't there. And so a homie said, hey, while you were gone, we were visited by an MVP. And I said, do you mean like a VIP? He goes, yeah, that one, VIP. And then he said, imagine here at Homeboy Industries, we were visited. By the Vice President of the United States, Mick Romney, he said.
Mick Romney.
I said, oh, fool, it's...
Big Joe Biden.
It's Joe Biden. So I think we're going to offer a current affairs class now at Homeboy. But he came 1 hour's notice, Secret Service, and it was motorcade, entourage, big deal.
I bet.
And he says, "No, I want to have lunch at Homegirl Cafe."
Awesome.
It was nice, and he was great. Every selfies with everybody. He didn't have to say no to anybody. It was really Secret Service were freaking out, you know, because here are all these guys with tattoos and big vodka.
What can people donate to Homeboy Industry? Because when I got married, I didn't want no presents for my wedding, so I made everybody donate to Homeboy Industry.
Yeah, thank you.
Father Rafi May hooked it up. A lot of comedians.
Yeah, that's great. Yeah,
what can they donate at? Homeboyindustry.com?
Homeboyindustries.org.
.org.
You have the link on the website.
Can't believe somebody to homeboyindustry.com.
Yeah.
Homeboyindustry.org. I remember on your interviews on CNN, one of the interviews you said, nothing stops a bullet faster than a job.
Like a job, yeah.
Have to have something to do.
Something to do, man.
That's right.
Because, man, it gets boring, bro, just eating ice cups all day.
Yeah, but it's too. But activities, too, for the discarded youth. I mean, there That's has right. to be something to do for everybody. I mean,
give them a reason to get up in the morning. And a reason to take a bus to Culver City to change sheets.
I know, right?
Hotel.
I know. Yeah. The other guy you hooked up with a job bomb, I think they used to call him Green. He's a correspondent on Law & Order now for like 10 years now.
Yeah.
Awesome, dude.
Consultant, bro. Like, whenever.
No, he's a line producer. I mean, he's.
Line producer.
Yeah, he's up there.
That's what's up, dude.
That's and, 20 years he's been
20
doing
years now, bro. And me and that guy, bro, we used to break into his grandma's house.
And Critter, do you remember Critter?
Critter, yes.
He's
Critter.
Another one who's in the. He's worked on every Jim Carrey movie, all these major comedies as kind of whatever it is.
Also, Grace's sister. She works as a producer, line producer, in commercials.
Not Grace's sister, Grace.
Grace, my bad. Yeah.
Yeah, Rose's.
Rose always sister. Busy. Always out of town.
Yeah, she's doing really well. Yeah, commercials for stuff.
And then a couple of people got city jobs, like Mago.
That's right. Mago, yeah.
Giving out Our Life Matter t-shirts. That's funny, man.
Then
there's the people who say he never got me a job, and then you go to their family, but you're always on drugs. Not once did you stop.
Well, it has to be a two-part system, too.
Right? Maybe halfway.
Hand
it to you.
Then you go, yeah, man, he gave me a job, but then they took me to jail, bro. But you were, bro, making tortillas and slagging on the side.
That's right. Double dipping.
A lot of them were double dipping, huh?
Yeah.
Man, what's the name? One of my friends still works there, Jesus Covarrubias, I think.
Yeah.
Yeah, my buddy right there.
Yeah, yeah.
Him and I used to play baseball. He's a great baseball player. So what's up, fool? Father Greg Boyle in the house.
Thank you. Great being with you guys.
We only even touched a little bit, bro, but thank you very much, man, for it. Helping me out in my life and my trail.
My honor.
Yeah, man. And I'm for real, man. You want to donate some money? Homeboyindustries.org. Nothing stops a bullet faster than a job.
You're a true treasure.
If you need anybody, man, anybody, you need somebody like to teach them how to weld or anything, man, they'll do it, huh?
Mm-hmm.
I think one of the last jobs I saw, you guys were installing solar panels.
Solar panels, that's right.
It's awesome.
Go certified.
Man. Homeboy solar panels, man. They're solar panels. They're made out of hairnets. Also, they have Homeboy Industry skill screening. If you guys need some skill screen, if you guys need shirts done, go to Homeboy Industry. Skill screen is run by my homie, Ruben. Ruben Rodriguez.
That's right.
Yeah. You guys need Yeah Man t-shirts, hit me up. I got a new batch. Sunset Room on Monday nights.
If you guys want to get a Homeboy Industry pink t-shirt, get them there too. What's up, fool? Yeah, man.
Have a good one. Thank you very much.
Get it.
Hey, thank you.